Lord a hand clap of praise in here tonight, this morning. Good morning, everybody. My name is Brantney Shafar Avery, and I am a senior political science major at the University of Memphis. And today I'm just here to briefly talk about my testimony and my journey along with my mom. I am a co-survivor. My mom, she was diagnosed with breast cancer at the end of 2014, transitioning to the 2015 year. It was a very hard process, y'all, you know, trying to get ready for final exams. And then your mom called you, I'm gonna have breast cancer. You know, it was a very interesting event, but God is able, y'all. He is very able. And I'm just glad that she's still here. She's coming on her 2-year mark of breast cancer. And I can just truly attest that God's grace is truly amazing. And his mercy endures forever and ever. And I'm just so grateful to stand here before y'all today and just let you know that God is a healer. He can do exceedingly and above anything that you can ask. And I'm just grateful again. And if there are any ladies in here, if you're afraid, you know, to get tested, you know, please, you know, develop the courage, because early detection is very important, because we caught my mom's breast cancer in a very early stage. And so, you know, it could have been worse, y'all, but she made it out, and I'm grateful to, you know, stand beside her and share this testimony. So thank you all for having me. Oh, let me say one more thing, I'm sorry. I wanna charge all the ladies in this room today to first, know your risk, know your bodies, get screened, or encourage someone to get screened, and lastly, live a healthy lifestyle. Thank you.
Thank you. the glory of the Lord rise among us. Would you give the souls for Christ and our singers a big hand today? You know, in the Greek language, the word glory, when we hear the word glory in the Greek language, it means the nature and the character and the ways of God. And so what they're saying to us and what we're saying to God is, God, let us be like you. Let your nature, let your character, let your ways fill our hearts and our minds and our spirits. That your glory would rise up in us. That we would be full of power. We would be full of faith. We would be full of praise. We would be full of love. We would be full of forgiveness. That we might get along with each other. That we might rise to the level. That we'll be the head and not the tail. The leader and not the follower. The Lord and not the feet. And all of our situations and circumstances would be crumbled under our feet. Because we walk in the fullness of God's glory. God, let your glory rise among us on this day. In the name of Jesus. I wish I had about 3 people who understood what it means to walk in the fullness of God's glory. Your holy and your righteous name. Open our eyes, God, that we might see you. Open our ears, Lord, that we might hear you. Open our hearts today, O God, that we might experience your presence in all of your splendor and in all of your glory. Give us a glimpse of the purpose that you established for us. Help us to see the challenges and the obstacles that we must overcome in order to walk in that purpose. And let us know above everything else that whatever we face and wherever we go, God, you are with us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 1. I want to look at verses 6 and 7. Some of you have heard today's message before. I invite you to hear it again for the very first time. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6. Paul writing here to his protege, Timothy, says, therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of self-discipline. I want to share with you today just from that one word, fear. Fear. To be fearful means to be timid and cowardly. To be timid and cowardly. It is a person who is passive rather than assertive. It is a person who is afraid to do what they know they should do. It is a person who realizes that if I overcome this fear and I face this challenge, my life will be better, but the fear keeps them from doing those things that they know they should do. Fear rises through our thoughts, it rises through our feelings, and it rises through our emotions. Fear is something that we all have, but courage is the ability to overcome the fear. Although we usually won't admit it, almost everyone is subject to fear. In fact, sometimes we don't even realize that we are fearful. There are two situations in particular that strikes fear in the mind and in the heart of most people. First, it's fear of the unknown. When we can't really know, we can't really see where we're going, we don't know what we're faced with, then we're afraid to tackle that challenge. But what we have to understand, for those of us who know and love the Lord, that faith is the substance of things hoped for, and it's the evidence of things not seen. I'll come back to that. So when we don't know something, that's no reason for us to be afraid, because we understand that God is still with us. The second reason that many people fear is that we fear change. Some of you will go back home over the Thanksgiving and the Christmas break, and you're a senior, you're a junior, you've been at Lane College, and you've been striving hard to get an education and change your life and to better yourself. But when you go back home, you'll be afraid that if you tell people that you have changed, they won't like you anymore, that they will call you bougie. It makes no sense to me for you to work that hard to get an education, to better your life, and then go back and say, I have not changed. Just afraid of what people are going to say. I got delivered some years ago from the mindset that I have not changed. I tell you, I am a different man than I was just a few months ago. Why? Because I'm progressively growing. And we are afraid of change. We're afraid to do something different. We're afraid to go places that we've never gone before. Why? Primarily because of fear. Oh, we'll say that we just like the way that we are. We'll say that we want the things to stay the way that they are. But if you wanted things to stay the way that they were, why did you leave home in the first place? Fear keeps us from recognizing that change is a good thing. As a student at Lane College, you face both the unknown and you face change. There are three sources from which our thoughts, I said earlier that our thoughts and our feelings and our emotions allow fear to come. And there are three sources from which our thoughts, our feelings, and our emotions come. They come from God. They come from Satan, the devil, and let me tell you, there is a devil. There are evil spirits. There are things that are operating in the world that you cannot see, that we cannot see, but they have a profound impact on the things that we can see. And at the head of those things that we cannot see is God and God's adversary, which makes him our adversary, the devil. And fear comes, our emotions, our thoughts, and our feelings either come from God, they come from Satan, or in many instances, they come from our own thoughts, our own souls, our own mind, and our hearts. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7 makes it very clear that fear does not come from God. It says God has not given us a spirit of fear. If our thoughts and our emotions and our feelings come from God, Satan, or from ourselves, and fear is the emotion that we're talking about today, and it does not come from God, that only leaves two other places. And the fear that comes through our own mind is often given to us by the spirits that the devil uses against us to keep us from being who God created us to be. And we need to recognize that. And so the majority of our fear comes from or through Satan. Satan is an adversary. An adversary is an opponent in a lawsuit or a legal matter. What I'm saying to you today, what I want you to understand, what I want you to think about, what I want you to ponder, what I want you to realize is that God has a perfect and wonderful plan for your life. God desires for you to be blessed abundantly. God desires for you to be blessed everywhere you go and in everything that you do. God desires for you to walk. God desires for you to be great. Satan, the adversary, 1 Peter 5 and 8 says he walks about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So God wants you to be great, and Satan wants to snuff out your greatness. God fills your heart and mind with courage and with the thinking of things that goes beyond what you even think about yourself. Satan fills your mind with fear and tells you that you can't do all of these things. And so there's this war that's going on for your heart, for your mind, for your soul, and we need to recognize what is happening to us. And so in a legal sense, Satan can only do what God allows him to do, or better still, what we allow him to do when we fail to have faith in the things that God says about who we are, about what we can do, and about what we can have. And so Satan walks around each day looking for someone to devour, looking for prey. 1 Peter 5:8 says, our adversary, the devil, walks about as a roaring lion. The thing about a roaring lion is that it is the roar that really causes the problems when we face the lion. The lion really can't do much to us, in fact, won't do much to us until the lion roars, causes us to be afraid, and paralyzes us, and then pounce. And so what I'm really saying to us today in this example is that Satan really can do no more to us than we allow him to do through the fear that he instills in us. God has a perfect and a wonderful plan for your life, and God wants you to walk in courage. God wants you to walk in impossibility thinking. God wants to do exceeding abundantly above all that you could ever ask or think. And the only way that the enemy, the adversary of God, can stop you is to control your thinking, is to make you think that you cannot. And one of the major ways that the enemy does that is by instilling fear in our hearts. When animals look for prey, they look for the most vulnerable. Ignorance, deception, and fear increase our vulnerability. So when we face the unknown, it almost always strikes fear in our hearts and in our minds. And we need to recognize that. And then sometimes fear is difficult for us to detect. In fact, there is a fear that most of us have that we don't even realize that we have. And it is the fear of success. Let me say that again. There's a fear that many of us have that we don't even realize that we have. And it is the fear of success. And so we tell ourselves all of these things, we give ourselves all of these reasons why we can't be successful. I came from the hood. My daddy wasn't around. Nobody in my family went to college. We bombard our minds with all of these reasons why we can't be successful, because we are afraid to even try. But Scripture says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So if it doesn't come from God, then it has to come either from our own mind, or more likely it comes from the adversary, whose desire it is to keep us from walking in the fullness that God has established for our lives. And so he instills this fear in us. And so when we face the unknown, when we face change, it almost always strikes fear in our hearts and in our minds, and is designed to keep us from being successful, abundantly successful, which is another thing that many of us are afraid of. Many of us are afraid of success, and so therefore we don't try. We dare tell someone, I'm going to make a 4.0 this semester, because we're afraid that we can't do it. And so we just walk around and act like we don't care. But deep down inside, we want more for our lives. If you didn't want more for your life, you wouldn't be at Lane College. You want more for your life. So when we think about these things, we think about fear, we need to spend some time thinking about what we want out of life and what we must do in order to be successful in life. And when we think on these questions, when we think about what we want and we think about what we have to do to be successful, then we have to face both our fears, and we have to face the possibility that God desires for us to live a successful, in fact, an abundantly successful life. And if you're going to get to that success, that level of success that God desires for you, and if you're going to stay there. See, sometimes people get to where God wants us to be, but we don't stay there. We do well on one exam, and then the next time we go back to our old habits and we don't do well again. But if you're going to get there, and if you're going to stay there, you have to conquer fear. And so I want to share with you just three biblical truths about fear that we need to know if we're going to conquer fear. To conquer fear means that we win a victory over fear that pales in comparison to anything else. It means that even when we have fear and it grips our mind and our hearts, we don't let it hold us back. Some of us won't even try big things because we're afraid that we'll fail. You wouldn't tell your friends that you're going to make a 4.0 this semester, even if it's in the back of your mind, because you're afraid that if you miss it, then somebody's going to talk about you. So it's not even in our minds to set and establish big goals for ourselves. So let me just say a couple of things to us as it relates to how we need to approach this thing of fear. Number one, we need to know that faith in God conquers fear. Faith in God conquers fear. Faith in God conquers fear. 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 5. Paul says, when I call to remembrance the genuine faith that is in you, which dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded is also in you. Faith helps us to overcome and to conquer those things that we are afraid of. And we need to have faith. We need to know that God desires great things for us. That God desires big things for us. And so when I say it takes faith to overcome fear, I simply mean that you must believe that you can. The Bible says that with God, all things are possible. And so when a thought comes into your mind about what you want to do in life and what you want to accomplish in life, rather than thinking that you can't do that, you need to remind yourself that with God, all things are possible. And when you have faith in who God is, it overcomes the lack of ability that you have. For with God, all things are possible. So in order to believe that you can overcome fear, you must first acknowledge that fear is there. And once you acknowledge that fear is there, then you begin to walk with God and you understand that there is an essential element that God has given you. There's a purpose and a plan that God has established for you that will allow you to conquer and accomplish things that will even blow your own mind. Because that's what God desires for you. The second thing that we need to realize is that God has given you gifts to overcome fear. God has filled your heart with all kinds of gifts that will enable you to overcome fear. So in 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6, it says, therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. That simply means that each one of us have been gifted uniquely by God. There are certain qualities and characteristics that God has given unto you that's a part of your DNA. It's a part of who you are. And if you will walk with God and if you will trust God and you will allow God to stir up those gifts that are down on the inside of you, you can conquer whatever challenge you face. You can overcome whatever it is that is set before you because God has given you the ability to do it. And we are afraid sometimes to even walk in the ability. God puts a big thought in our mind and we won't even tell anybody else what that thought is because we're afraid that we can't accomplish it. And he's saying here, stir that up. It's like paint that you put in a can. When you get paint and you put it in a can and it sits for a while, the paint is not the true color it is until you get a paint stick and stir it up and mix up all of the elements that are down on the inside of you. What I'm saying, there's stuff down on the inner parts of your belly. There's stuff down on the inside of your mind. There are goals and plans and purposes and things that you desire that are lying dormant on the inside of you that are bigger than you ever think you could accomplish yourself. And you just need to allow your faith in God. You just need a big old faith stick and sit in the presence of God and let God stir up so that it can rise to the top so that you can be all that God has created you to be. Your eyes have not seen, your ears have not heard, neither has it entered into your mind the things that God has prepared for you to those who love them, but God has revealed them unto you by your spirit. That's why sometimes in the middle of the night you wake up with these big dreams and these big plans.
but you're afraid to write them down. You're afraid to tell somebody. Why? Because while you were asleep with the television off and all of your friends and all of the things that folks have told you down through the years that you could not do, God has begun to speak into your heart about what you can do. And you wake up with this big dream in your mind and you think, where did that come from? You need to take that big old faith stick and you need to stir it up so that everything that's down on the inside of you, all that God has created you to be, all of your intellect, all of your beauty, all of your courage, everything that the devil has tried to stop out of your life, you need to stir up so that you can be all that God has called you to be, because he has gifted you. And there's a faith that lies down on the inside of you. And you need to be able to walk in that. And then he says here, 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7, he says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear. Now, if God didn't give it to you, then you don't need it. Let me say that again. If God didn't give it to you, then you don't need it. There's really only two places that these kind of characteristics and qualities come from. They come from God, or they come from God's adversary, the enemy, who is the devil. Now, the devil works through other folks, and other folks do his bidding. But when people start to talk to you about, you can't do this, and you can't do that, you came from the other side of the tracks, and your granddaddy was this, and your grandmama was that, and your grandmama was the other, you need to understand that God didn't give you that. And God, if God didn't give it to me, then I don't need it. And you need to stir what's down on the inside of you and realize that I can rise above my circumstances. Why? Because God has not given me a spirit of fear. Don't be afraid to say I'm going to make a 4.0 this semester. Don't be afraid to say that I'm going to graduate and go on to graduate school. Don't be afraid to look Dr. Hampton in the eye and say I'm going to be the president of Lane College or some other college one day. Why? Because God has not given you a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. A sound mind means when impossibility comes into your mind, you hold the thought captive and say, I'm not going to think about that. I'm going to take that. I'm going to hold it. I'm going to cast it down. You will not run free in my mind. I can make a 4.0. I can graduate. I can go to graduate school. I can do whatever it is that deep down inside when I'm asleep, God speaks to my heart and I'm afraid to tell other people that I can do. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do it. Why? Because I'm walking in faith, not in fear. God has not given me a spirit of fear, but God has given me power. This word power literally means dunamis. It's dynamite power. Now, the thing about dynamite that you have to realize, though, is that you have to use it carefully. Because if you don't place it just right, it'll tear stuff up. And that's what some of us do. We take the very power, the very intellect, the very wisdom that God has given to us, all of our personality, and we're very charismatic, and we can get people to follow us, but we're not using it for constructive things. We're using it for destructive things. Stop worrying about how you're going to sell drugs. Stop worrying about how you're going to hit and quit. Stop worrying about all those things and understand that God didn't give you those gifts and abilities for you to do destructive things. God gave them to you for you to do godly things and glorious things, things that will make your life better and make your neighborhood better and make your children's life better and make your children's children's life better. For a good man leaves an inheritance to his children. God didn't give you all of that ability, all of that intellect to run around here trying to figure out how you can get over. He gave it to you so you'll understand how you can make it through. So we need to realize that God has given us power and love, the ability to be benevolent and to show positive things toward others and to do good things in other people's life. And then he says, power and of love and of a sound mind. That word sound mind, that phrase sound mind is translated in some versions as self-discipline. Self-discipline is when you wake up and realize that you need to go to the library, but you want to go hang out.
And you say, I'm not going to hang out, I'm going to the library. Self-discipline is when you have ate four plates and you know you're full and you just keep on eating. That's self-discipline. Self-discipline. God has given you a spirit of self-discipline to control yourself. Self-discipline is when you want to roll over and sleep just a few more minutes because you realize you got an 8 o'clock class. But self-discipline says that I need to get up and be in class on time and beat the teacher. That's self-discipline. Self-discipline for your athlete is when you have run all of your sprints and you just got one more left and you figure I'm just going to coast on this one. Self-discipline says, I'm going to run this one to the fullest because when I get in the fourth quarter, I might need a little better condition. That's what self-discipline is. Self-discipline says, I've read all of the chapters, but I don't fully understand it, so I'm going to go back and read it again. I'm going to send my teacher an email so I can understand what I want to understand. That's self-discipline, and that's what God has given unto you. Power, love, and a sound mind. Self-discipline. Self-discipline simply means that you do what other people don't want to do now so that you can do what they cannot do later. Self-discipline, let me say that again. It means that you do what other people don't want to do now so that you can do what they cannot do later. Finally, we need to realize that courage comes from God. Courage comes from God. Let me turn there quickly. Joshua chapter 1. In other words, what I'm saying to you is that it takes courage to overcome. It takes courage to do those things that I talked about. It takes courage to walk in the fullness of who you are and the fullness of what God has called you to be. And in order for you to walk in the fullness of who you are and in the fullness of what God has called you to be, to walk in this love and this power and this sound mind, then you're going to have some courage. God says in Joshua chapter 1 and verse 5, He says, no one shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so will I will be with you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. Let me tell you what that means to you. It means that if someone else has done it, you can do it too. He says, as I was with them, I'll do it for you. There's no one else. If you have a goal and a plan, there's something you want to accomplish. My daddy used to say this to me. He's going home to be with the Lord. I used to say, Daddy, I can't do that. And he'd look at me and I'd say, is anybody else doing it? Well, if anybody else is doing it, then you can do it too. That means it's possible. And then he used to say, my daddy was an old farmer. He used to say, Cain died a long time ago. And they whooped Cain until he could. He didn't say it just like that. In other words, stop telling yourself what you can't do. Stop telling yourself that it's impossible for you. Stop telling yourself where you come from and start telling yourself where you're going. Stop telling yourself what you don't have and stop telling yourself what you do have. Stop telling yourself what you see others do and you're buying them for doing it. And talk close to God and find out what God wants you to do and do what God has called you to do. Because that's what God has established for you. God says, I will not leave you, nor will I forsake you. Verse 6, he says, this is Joshua chapter 1, verse 6, he says, only be strong and of good courage, for to this people you shall divide as an inheritance to the land which I swore to the fathers to give them. In other words, he's saying, if you walk in the courage and the possibility that I've given unto you, not only will you be blessed yourself, but you'll have enough overflow where you can bless somebody else's life. You'll be in a position where you can help somebody else. And that's why God sends you to college. Don't let nobody make you think that God sends you to college, allows you to come to college, just so you can get a job. That's not what God wants. Desires for you. God has sent you to an institution where you can rise above, where that you can have more than what you need for yourself, so that you can be a blessing to somebody else's life. He wants you to have an overflow, more than what you need, so you can help somebody else, and don't let the devil take that from you. He says in verse 7 of Joshua chapter 1, only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all that the law. In verse 8, he says, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night. Now, I know it's not popular to tell you that you need to read the Bible, but if you're going to walk in what I'm talking about today, you need to read the Bible. It shall not depart from your mouth. It shall not depart from your eyes. It is the truth about all of creation, and you need to read it and understand it so that you will realize what God desires for you. I got news for you. The enemy and anyone who is an enemy of the good things that God has for you does not want you to have a relationship with God, and does not want you to walk with God, and does not want you to read, not only read the Bible, don't even want you to read your books. Half of you don't even go buy your books. And I don't want to be mean and nasty about that, but God desires for you to have knowledge in your head and wisdom in your mind. And you're worried about the cost of the books. It's not a cost, it's an investment. And the difference between an expense and an investment is that when you invest in something, you get a return back that's far greater than what you spent. Stop worrying about how much the book costs and start focusing on how much of a return it's going to bring back to you, because God has a great, wonderful, and abundant plan for your life. Fear will prevent you from walking in the fullness that God desires for you. The exact opposite of fear is faith. Fear says you can. Faith says you can't, except you have the power of God and the wisdom of God to help you. Fear says it's impossible. Faith says with God all things are possible. Fear causes you to live beneath the standard that God desired for you to live. Faith causes you to live above the standard that anybody else could ever think or imagine for you. Your eyes have not seen, your ears have not heard, neither has it entered into your heart what God has prepared to those who love them. But God has revealed it unto you by God's Spirit. Let me tell you what that means. That means that many of you know that God has great and wonderful things in store for you, but you're afraid to go after them. And God is saying to you today, don't let fear hold you back. God is saying to you today, overcome fear with courage. Overcome fear with faith. Don't allow yourself to be caught in a situation where that you're going to live beneath the purpose and the plan that God has established for your life. You have to have the courage to be different. You have to have the wisdom and the knowledge to understand that God has a wonderful purpose and a wonderful plan for your life. And if you will draw close to God, if you will draw near to God, all of the things that you desire in your life, God will allow you to achieve them, and even greater, because God wants to work through your life to be a blessing to somebody else. Your heads are bowed. Your heads are bowed. Your heads are bowed. Your eyes are closed. Your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed. You're not talking. Your heads are bowed and your eyes are closed because you realize right now that God is preparing to make a deposit into your heart that will change your outlook on life and that will enable you to see the abundant life that God desires for you. You realize as you close your eyes and open up your heart that God is preparing exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you could ever think or ask, through the power of God's Spirit. And you feel it, you sense it working in and through your heart, even as you bow your head right now, in the name of Jesus. And Father God, I'm praying, I'm trusting in you to touch and to draw by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we look to you today, and we trust in you, O God, for all of the things that you want to do in the hearts of those who are under my voice. And now, Father, we ask that you would speak and make clear the purpose and the plan that you have for each one. As you're sitting in your seats, and as the Spirit of God and the Word of God is flowing through your mind, and you realize today that God desires more for you than you've been imagining for yourself, and you want to be able to walk into what God is desiring for you. God desires more for you than you've been imagining for yourself. God desires more for you than what others have spoken over your life about who you can be. I want you to just repeat after me. It's a prayer. And I want you to repeat it. Say, "Dear Lord, I trust you on this day. I confess that Jesus is Lord. And I ask you to fill my heart with his grace. And Lord, from this day forward, I will conquer fear. I will not allow the thinking that says to me that things are impossible. For I heard today that with you, all things are possible. So from this day forward, I will walk in the possibilities that you created me to walk in. In Jesus' name, amen and amen." Amen. God bless you. God keep you. There are some things that people have to give you at the end as you walk out. I'll make sure that you see it.